Okay, so welcome back everybody. So in this video I'm going to discuss Cochran CRM, and I'll first explain what does the CRM say, and then I will also give a proof of the CRM, or at least most of a proof. And that CRM is one of the more important results in the module, and we are going to use that repeatedly. We use part of the statement now in the last part of the section, but we'll use much more of the CRM in the next lectures when we discuss confidence intervals and tests. So that's an important thing, and it's slightly technical, so it may make sense for you to watch this video a few times and to go through the notes a few times just to be sure that you pick up all the details of that important result. Okay, so let's have a start with this. That is a CRM which tells us something about quadratic forms, and a quadratic form is if you have a matrix A and then multiply the same vector to it from the left and from the right. So if A is a matrix, X is a vector, then X transpose AX is a quadratic form. And the Cochran theorem, the vectors are random vectors, so that tells us something about epsilon transpose H epsilon, for example, and it will also tell us something about epsilon transpose I minus H epsilon. Good, and what I want to do here now is, we know is normal distributed mean zero covariance matrix sigma squared times identity. Here in this video I want instead to consider a vector Z which has just an n-dimensional standard normal distribution, and I'll not bother with the sigma squared, and in the notes I do the proper version with the sigma squared. So here for just this section in the video I will assume sigma squared is 1, and to make the difference I will write Z instead of epsilon, and then when you read the notes you can find the version with the proper epsilon and the sigma squared. So here let's just say Z transpose HZ and Z transpose I minus HZ, where Z is standard normally distributed in n dimensions, so that means Z1 up to Zn are standard normally distributed numbers and they are independent. Good, so Cochran's theorem asserts these two quantities are independent of each other and they are chi-squared distributed each. So let's do that slowly. So first what we need is we need a result from linear algebra, and that says if a matrix, I call it H already, is symmetric, then it can be diagonalized. And what that means is that we can write H as U transpose DU, where U is orthogonal and D is diagonal. D is diagonal, so it has only diagonal elements, and the diagonal elements, it turns out, are the eigenvalues of H. So these are often called lambda. So D looks like this, and the only degree of freedom you have there is you can reorder the diagonal element, but otherwise it's unique. So H, if you count the multiples properly, has n eigenvalues, and that's just numbers you are given, and they are on the diagonal, so there is very little choice. You can just rearrange them. But U is not unique at all. Like, minus U would, for example, do the same job as U, because minus here and a minus here would cancel. And similarly, you can just change the sign of individual columns, I believe, and still nothing would change. If we plug that in into, let's first do this equation, then what we get is, so we have Z transpose HZ is Z transpose U transpose the diagonal matrix UZ, and remember Z was standard normally distributed in n dimensions, and you see that is still a quadratic form, so this here is UZ transpose DUZ. Good, and let's call this eta, this vector uz, so that's eta transpose d eta, and that differs from the eta in the notes by, again, the eta in the notes has the sigma in. Good, now eta we can understand, namely eta is UZ, and we know what happens to a normal distribution when I apply a matrix. So the mean is just multiplied by U. U times 0 is 0. And the covariance matrix is multiplied by U from the left and U transpose from the right. So we get N0 U U transpose. That's the moment where we need to understand what orthogonal means. An orthogonal matrix U is defined as either U transpose U is identity or U transpose is identity, and these two properties are equivalent, so if one of them holds, the other holds. So the orthogonal matrix has U U transpose and U transpose U are both the identity. So the transpose and the inverse is the same thing for an orthogonal matrix. So what that does is here, UU transpose is identity. And if you look, that looks familiar, that's the same distribution as Z. And I spoke about how the normal distribution is uniquely determined by its mean and its covariance matrix. So that UZ, which I called eta, that has the same distribution as Z. Eta is also a vector, that's right, eta 1 up to eta n, and eta I are also standard normally distributed and independent. Just as an aside, from the form of this matrix, you can immediately see that the components of eta are uncorrelated. The off-diagonal elements are zero, but normally uncorrelatedness does not imply independence. But here in this case, we know eta follows a normal distribution, and for a normal distribution, that's a special case. Here we can make this argument, eta has the same distribution as Z, therefore it must be the same, and Z, we said, had independent component. So here we actually get independence. Great. So looking back to that, we started with the quadratic form we are interested in. We got this quadratic form, but you see, nothing has changed. We have just argued eta has the same distribution as Z. Only we have improved things. Instead of H, we have this diagonal matrix D here. Great. Now comes another bit. Namely, we know H is idempotent. So we know H squared equals H. I showed this in the previous video. And that has consequences for eigenvalues. So assume hx is lambda x. That would mean lambda is an eigenvalue of h. Then what we get is h squared x is, well, we can apply them one after another. That's h of x. That's h of lambda x. That's lambda h of x. And then the other one, that is lambda times lambda x, is lambda squared of x. So if I apply h twice, I get the eigenvalue twice. But if we continue that to the other side, then we know h squared of x is h of x equals lambda x, and x is a non-zero vector, so we have this vector, and we have just found if I multiply the vector with lambda, changing its length, then I get the same thing as if I multiply it with lambda squared, changing its length. So lambda and lambda squared must be the same thing. And that is a rather peculiar condition. Number equals number squared, so there are only two numbers which does this. Namely, lambda must be either 0 or 1. If we have a parabola, that's lambda squared, and a straight line, these two curves intersect just in two points, namely at 0 and at 1. So we know that all eigenvalues of h are either 0 or 1. So this diagonal matrix, which I said has the eigenvalues on the diagonal, that has actually only ones and zeros on the diagonal. And we don't know where they are. Here for this video, I will just assume it's ordered so that the ones are at the start and the zeros at the end. But it does not matter for the argument. It's just for me to be able to draw the matrices. Now the question is, how many ones are there and how many zeros are there? And here I leave a small gap because you need to know a bit more linear algebra for that. So H is x, x transpose, x inverse, x transpose. And we had long ago assumed, that's built in here already, that X transpose X is invertible. And one can show, if one is using a bit more linear algebra than I'm willing to use here, that that means that X has full rank. And for a matrix with P plus 1 columns, the maximal possible value is P plus 1. So that's what is required to make the inverse exist. So it cannot be done at all if n is smaller than p plus 1, and if n is larger, then the columns are not allowed to be linearly dependent. Otherwise, the rank would be smaller. It needs independent columns so that we have this. And then using the same techniques, which I'm still not going to discuss here, that then also means that rank h equals p plus 1. That is because here's an x, which we said has rank p plus 1, and this matrix is invertible, it doesn't do anything. Well, that does not restrict your choice of which columns you can address here. And then the only question is to do with the X transpose. But I want to say that does not mean H has full rank, because H is much larger. H is an n times n matrix, so these columns will be dependent of each other. And there are just enough of them independent that we get rank is p plus 1. So there's this, and I put that in brackets here, but now that helps us, namely D and H are equivalent matrices. That's just a change of basis if you look at it in linear algebra language. And it turns out that does not change the rank, so D has the same rank as H. And rank means the number of linearly independent columns, and these columns here are zero, they cannot be linearly independent to anything, so it must be done by the first ones. And this means there will be p plus 1 entries on the diagonal, which are 1, and then n minus p minus 1 entries, which are 0. And again, it's not guaranteed that the ones are on top, I just did it for my convenience, but somewhere on this diagonal are p plus 1 ones, and the remaining entries will be 0. Now, the thing we are interested in is Z transpose HZ. We said it's eta transpose diagonal eta. So we need to look at this a bit. So there are two products here. And that is a number. The dimensions are 1, n, n, and 1. So to get there, we need two summations. So I and j from 1 to n. And then we have eta I, d, I, j, eta j. Good, D is diagonal, so that gets only contributions if I equals J. So we have some I from 1 to N, eta I, D I, eta I, all the other terms are 0. And that is some I from 1 to N, and I just write that in words a bit informally. So that is eta I squared if D I equals 1, and 0 if D I equals 0. That's along this diagonal, things are multiplied with dii, and somewhere on the diagonal are p plus 1 terms, which are 1. These lead to eta I times 1 times eta I, so these lead to these eta I squared terms, and all the other diagonal elements are 0, that leads to these zeros. Okay, so still writing in words, that is the sum of the squares of p plus 1 independent standard normals, because eta I is standard normal. Again, when you look at the notes, there will be an extra sigma, which I'm not mentioning here. In the notes at this point, I have to divide the whole expression by sigma squared to make these standard normals and not normals with variance sigma squared. So that works out too. And some of independent standard normals, if you know this business, you know what that is. So that is, by definition, is chi-squared distribution with p plus 1 degrees of freedom. The chi-squared distribution is defined as just this. It's the distribution which you get if you take standard normals, square them, add them up. And the degrees of freedom, this number here, that is how many did you add up. And, well, the answer is here. We added up p plus 1 of them. While I'm here, we can work out the expectation of this. That's not part of the proof, but we'll need it later. So expectation of some I from 1 to n dii eta I squared is, well, there are p plus 1 terms which contribute, and each of them contributes expectation of eta I squared, but that thing here is 1 because that's the variance, but eta I are standard normal distributed, so that's p plus 1. What we have just shown is the expectation of a chi-squared distribution equals the number of degrees of freedom, so p plus 1 for us. So let's not worry about that now, but we are going to use this in a little while. Good, so we have shown the first statement of the theorem, which says that thing is chi-squared distributed with p plus 1 degrees of freedom. Now, the next term, one needs to go through exactly the same procedure, only I minus h, if you diagonalize it, turns into I minus d. So, h is u transpose d u. From that we get I minus h is, I can write as u transpose u, even better u transpose identity u, it's still identity, minus u transpose d u. And now I take u transpose out on the left and then u on the right. So I get this. So I minus h I can still diagonalize, but the diagonal matrix is I minus d. Let me do my sketch of d. So if I do it like this, that I have the ones in the top just to have something to draw. So if that's d, p plus 1 entries here, n minus p minus 1 entries here, then I minus d, well, I is the diagonal matrix which has 1 everywhere, so here we get 1 minus 1 and get 0, and down here we get 1 minus 0, so we get 1, so we have still p plus 1 entries here, but they are now 0, and n minus p minus 1 entries here, which are 1, and you can see how that goes. Now we go through exactly the same argument, but now we have I minus d here, so these are swapped, so we get contributions for these terms, and there are n minus p minus 1 of them, so what we get is the other term is chi-squared distributed with n minus p minus 1 degrees of freedom. Same logic. And then the last statement is these two random variables are independent, and from our analysis that is also clear, namely, let's look again at this one. So we have n of these eta I random variables, and they're independent. And I said here only p plus 1 of them contribute, namely the ones where dii equals 1. The others, they just don't come into this expression because they are multiplied by 0, so they show up as 0 here. And then I said if we have I minus h here, they swap rows, so then I get all the terms where dii equals 0, because then 1 minus dii equals 1. So I get the other terms for Z transpose I minus H Z transpose. So these etas, which are independent, are split into two groups. P plus 1 of them contribute to this one, and the remaining N minus P minus 1 of them contribute to that one, but no term has input into both of them. So since the eta I are independent, we can immediately see some go here, some go there, none of the eta I goes into both, so these two also must be independent. So I just write that, so Z transpose HZ and Z transpose identity minus HZ are independent. And that's the proof, except I didn't do the sigma, so you need to now go to the notes, read that again, and see how the sigmas need to be squeezed in to get the same result with epsilon transpose h epsilon and epsilon transpose I minus h epsilon. Now I need to divide by sigma squared to get the chi-squared distribution, and they are still independent. Good, so that was what I wanted to say about Cochran's theorem, and as I mentioned at the start, that's an important result, and it's not totally easy, so please go ahead, read this section in the notes really careful, you may use a pen and paper to take notes, and make sure that you get all the details of that, because we will use it repeatedly, and it will be one of the main ingredients of the theory of linear regression. So go ahead, do that, and once you are familiar with all the details, in the last part of this section we'll see a first and quite simple application of this theorem. So see you soon in the next video.